So that's what that is. I thought something was wrong with my eyes. It turned, well, there is something very wrong with my eyes. I can't see too well, but I thought there was something going on when I came in here and I was setting everything up for today's program. And then I realized there's pollen all over my glasses. I thought everything seemed a little bit grainy today, but I usually pass that off to, it's probably just me. No, it's my glasses. It's because of this one. This, I'll actually show you this. This I call the Hydra. It looks ridiculous. And it is ridiculous, but it's absolutely delicious. I'll just do my program without glasses today. It doesn't matter if everything's blurry. I know you're all here. I want to do something for you. One last program here in the Voodoo Garden. It's not my last program on this channel. It's just my last program indoors. I'm going to be moving outdoors and doing some filming out there. There are some things that I want to mention about the whole process of growing indoors and specifically growing food indoors. I've actually learned quite a bit this final season of the Voodoo Garden, because remember back on my other channel, the Voodoo Garden, I mentioned that I was going to try and grow all the greens that I would need. I was going to grow them indoors the winter of 2020 and 2021 to see if I could grow enough to satisfy my need for greens, because this pesky virus has gotten me isolating and not going into the grocery store as much. I don't want to go in every few days to get lettuce, carrots, things like that. Things that I can't really store a long period of time. And I don't have room in my fridge. So I figure, well, I got to grow room. Why not just grow this stuff? And I did. Now, I learned some things that are great that I didn't expect, and also some limitations that I really didn't expect. I want to bring those out so that it might help you in the future if you would decide to grow indoors, whether it be summer, winter, whatever the case may be. I want to give you my the benefit of my mistakes and my successes. How's that sound? Let's start out with this one here. I got a few props, delicious props, but props nonetheless. This is hishiko, green onions, which are also known as spring onions. These don't form a bulb. They just grow the greens, and they have the white part underneath the soil. Tender, delicious, mild. The thing I like about green onions is that they are mild. You know, sometimes you cut into an onion and it just, you know, ruins your whole day. Well, green onions don't have that effect. They're mild. They have the oniony flavor, but more of a green flavor, a fresh green flavor, as opposed to the bulb onion. Those of you who have compared them, you know what I'm talking about. Those of you who have not, let's educate you about green onions. I grew these not because I wanted to pick the green onions and use them. I figured, how do I get the most bang for my buck? I got limited space. I'm paying for the lighting. In order to do this, I want to have as much, what they call it, biomass. I call it edibles from my small amount of soil that I can get. How would I do that with green onions? My way was to let them grow and mow them. What I do every now and then, basically about once a week, I will go to each plant, grab about this much, about half the plant, take the scissors and cut it off. That gives me the top half. It's like mowing the lawn. It's just like mowing the lawn. I am the lawn mower. I cut it off, chop it up, I put it into my salads, my scramble. I love onions with scrambled eggs. Some people just think that's disturbingly gross. I love it. I've always loved it. These go into everything. It gives you the mild oniony flavor, not the bulk mass of bulb onions, but a nice green oniony flavor, and they will grow back practically indefinitely. They've been doing this for months. So these plants, that's what I've been doing with them. What I did learn is that you need to keep up on this. If you really like green onions, this is the thing for you. If you only use them once in a blue moon, you're gonna get overwhelmed. It only took a pinch of seeds. One packet of seeds did three of these containers. I had two more over by you that I didn't bring out, but I got three of these containers from one little packet of seeds, and I have gotten onions all winter long with this. That is major bang for your buck. I like that. Now, I'm gonna keep chopping these off, and then when the end comes, which is very near, probably this week, I'm going to pull them all up over a container, shake off the soil, and then use the entire onion just like I would when I grow them outside. You know, you plant a seed, you get one onion plant, you pull it up, you eat it, that's the end of it. Well, with this, I got the greens all winter long, and then I get the onion on top of that. So I got so much more than I thought I would get. That was a lesson that I learned from indoor growing. Outdoors, I've done it a few times, but indoors, I had to do it a lot. And since I like green onions so much, this was a big bonus for me. I like that. I highly recommend it. If you like green onions and you can't grow them outside, or it's during the winter, grow them inside. Keep them under bright light. It keeps them nice and strong as opposed to really spindly. Low light, spindly plants. Not a good thing. Here's another one right over here. This is blue Scotch curled kale. This is something, you know, kale. When you mention kale around people who aren't vegetarian or vegan, generally they back off. They go, oh no, not another one of those where you have to throw it in a smoothie with like people who have kale smoothies. You got to throw in 5 tons of fruit and sugar in order to make it taste good. I was of that thinking too, and I learned something. I learned that I actually not just like, I love and I crave kale. I never thought I'd be that person. You know, I was one of those people that thought, oh, kale, no, it's just for people who want to be super healthy and go vegan and stuff like that. I know that's ignorant thinking, but that's how I was because I didn't know. And ignorance of something, for me, is a signal that I need to educate myself about it. And I did. I actually decided to grow one and experiment with it. And experiment I did. I tried eating it raw. I tried eating it sauteed. I tried eating it boiled, fried, all different kinds of ways I tried. And it turns out, I don't like cooked kale. Don't like it. I don't care how you cook it. I don't like it. So I'm at peace with that. One thing I did learn is, I love raw kale. Just raw. And I don't know if it's the specific type or if it's just the fact that I learned something accidentally. Accidental education for Ray is I just pick the leaf and I cut the leaf off close to the plant, the bottom leaves only, and then I take off all the green part and leave the rib, you know, the center part. That's a little bit too tough for me, and I just toss it away. But the curled part, I absolutely love. You should actually, you should get off the shelf over there and take a look at this and see what it looks like up close. It's a pretty little plant, isn't it? It is. It's a cute little plant. Now, outdoors, this would grow so much bigger. Indoors, they generally don't do as well as they do outdoors. These are the smaller leaves, the leaves that were underneath it. See, I harvest from the bottom up. I started at the very bottom. Those leaves were about maybe 5 times bigger than this one right here. They were ginormous. And those ones I just sliced off close to the plant at ground level. I've gotten a lot of those, and one leaf was enough for one person for a side salad for a meal. I also mix it with lettuce, the green onions over here. Show you these up close. Isn't that something? I would take off some of these, dice them up roughly, and then add them with this, and I would also, look at me just grabbing stuff and doing a little show and tell for you. I figured while you're down here, I might as well show you these things instead of seeing them from afar. This is that weird lettuce that is soft as silk. Somebody mentioned what kind it was, and I don't know. This reddish color is natural for it. With all of these lettuces, I've been harvesting the lower leaves and working my way up. Generally, you don't do that with lettuce. You just pick the head and get it over with when you're growing outside. I wanted to see, like I said, how much bang I can get for my buck. I've been harvesting from these lettuces for months. Not weeks, months. And look at this. It's turning into lettuce trees. Normally, when lettuce grows for a long period of time, it tends to get bitter or want to put up stalks and do flowers. Indoors, it's nice and cool. The light isn't too awful bright, so you don't get the heat on the leaves, which causes it to bolt. And I'm harvesting the bigger leaves from the bottom and letting the new leaves that come out lay down. I've mentioned that before, and that's how I got the most bang for my buck. I have 7 pots of lettuce doing the exact same thing. And I've been up to my neck in lettuce. It's not too much lettuce, it's a lot of lettuce. I can have lettuce greens every single day for months indoors off of just 7 seeds. So you can imagine if you had the room, what an entire packet of lettuce would do. You'd have lettuce for your family, your family's family, all kinds of lettuce, and you don't have to worry about bugs. That is the cool thing. And I don't even have to rinse them off because there's no dirt blowing around in here. I can take a leaf off and just, yeah, I won't do this now because some people gripe when I eat on camera, but I can just pull a leaf off and eat it because there's nothing, no dirt on it. There's no blowing dirt. There's not a single insect in here, which is really a blessing. So I am getting lettuce. That is something that I would recommend for indoors as well. Now, I got to bring over this. This is the mama plant. This right here. Now, I'm going to back you up. Well, actually, I'm going to take it off the tripod and move it around. Okay, hold on. This is the cherry tomato plant I'm growing. It's called the Praxis cherry. I've grown this. I've told you about this over and over and over. I've grown this over and over and got the genetics just right. It's flowering and it's fruiting. Look at this. See? It grows clusters of cherry tomatoes outdoors. These are rather large cherry tomatoes. Some are large, some are small, but most of them are very large. Indoors, these are about the size of regular cherry tomatoes. This plant, all the way down here, let me show you what the plant looks like. It's one plant. Yep, it does put out suckers, and every single one of these branches is a sucker. I let it grow up to about this tall, and then I cut it off, and look at this. It's got about 7 suckers coming out all the way around. And some gardeners will tell you to don't promote suckers because they weaken the plant. That's a myth. And I will go all the way out to say that's a lie. Because suckers do not drain a plant. Suckers give more from the plant. Don't think of them as suckers. Think of them as branches, and this is a tree. Branches don't weaken a tree. They actually are what feed the tree. Every one of these leaves is feeding this plant, and it has a nice healthy root system. This plant is doing so well, and it's doing so well in this tiny pot. I don't know if this is a 6-inch, 8-inch pot. It's a very small pot, look, compared to my hand. I have to water this every single day, but it's still surviving in that small of a pot, and it's producing. Normally, this would grow big. This is a big indeterminate plant, and it will produce hundreds, if not thousands, of cherries every single year, and they're absolutely delicious. Indoors, not so much. So it's very manageable indoors. You can chop off branches, you can prune it back, you can shape this any way you want. The nice thing is, you don't have to stake it. Nope, not indoors. Outdoors, maybe, but it's a very strong, active, healthy plant. And this is not it. Right here is the mother plant. And then I'm going to swing you over as non-jerky as I can. This is her daughter. This is a cutting. It was a small cutting that I took off and I planted it deep, and these little branches came out of it, and she is starting to flower. And I haven't pruned the branches off of this, the leaf branches. I like to keep them clipped off to keep the airflow going down there. And that's what I did to the mother over here. I clipped off all of those leaves in the center to allow light to get down in there. And also outdoors, if you do that, it helps the breeze and the air flow through to keep early blight. You know, the fungus that attacks a lot of your tomato plants? Yep. This one is resistant, naturally resistant to early blight. Last year, I grew this plant, or the year before, no early blight until late August, early September. Yep. That's her daughter right there. So that was a cutting off of her. And she has a twin. Yep. This is another cutting from the Praxis cherry tomato. So it's put out all of those tomatoes, all of that growth, and 2 babies, and I could even take cuttings off of this and exponentially make more and more plants. The reason I'm doing all of this isn't to just grow fruit indoors because they won't produce soon enough. What I'm doing is to strengthen these up and get them ready for outdoors, because I'll be growing these plants for production, for seeds for the website. Yeah, because people want to grow this and you can't order these seeds online. I have to produce every single seed I sell on my website. So I want to make sure that I have the strongest, best looking plants, and these are the ones that are going to be producing all of those seeds that hopefully you'll want to grow in your garden. If you want to grow indoors or outdoors, doesn't really matter. This is the culprit. This is the Michihili Asian cabbage. Similar to bok choy, but a whole different structure. It's, you know, there's a lot of plants in that family, but this is just one of them. This is the Michihili. I was harvesting those giant leaves off of it in previous programs, and you can see where I cut them off down here. Yes, We have feasted off of it. We have feasted off of this one plant all winter long, and I'm sick of it. Yes, I am. This is going to the goat, and yep, goat food with the leaves, with the flower. Look at this, the flowers. The flower stalks got tall, but then they got heavy with flowers, and of course they will produce seeds, yep. But I'm done. This plant is done. It's provided entertainment, education, food. It's done everything for us, and I'm really proud of it. Yet I'm going to be saying goodbye to this. One thing I did learn about this is you better like the taste of this if you're going to grow it, because you're going to get so much. Outdoors, the plants are out of this world. They produce way more. One plant is enough for me. And I can't even imagine growing a whole row of this stuff. If you like the flavor of Asian cabbage, this is definitely, it's definitely going to do good for you. And I'm also going to be eating this guy. It sounds really creepy when I mention my little friends here that I'm going to eat them. Yep, this is the, what was this? I forgot what you are. What are you? Do you have a tag? Yes. Oh, collards. Yep, collards. I ate all the big leaves off of it, but I'm going to be eating the smaller leaves too. That one I'm going to fry up. I like that fried up with onions. That's all I do. I just chop it up, fry it with onions, regular bulb onions, and then I serve it on top of stuff like either chicken, beef, pork, whatever I'm eating, I just throw it on top. And no other seasoning's necessary. One last look. I'm doing final looks because these plants are going to be taken out of the room and either eaten, planted in the garden. This one here, this was my corn, my bodacious corn, remember? It produced an ear, but the pollination didn't take effect. I have an empty ear, which is really kind of sad, but funny. And then it produced another ear. And this one looks, it feels like it has a little bulb thing down here, a little ear. Only problem is the tassels will never get pollinated because I chopped off the top. But I think Bucky is going to pick out on this. The goats love corn. So this is not going to go to waste. It was a fun plant to grow. You can grow corn indoors. People tell you you can't. Point it my way. And this is the last of the radishes. I've been slowly harvesting them and feeding them to the critters out in the coop because it was so cold, it's winter. They were very, very grateful to get the greens. And this is what it looks like. These have been growing for months and months and months, which normally you don't do with radishes. You know, 1 month after planting the seed, you're harvesting the whole thing. I ate the greens from two pans. There was three pans of this. And I couldn't eat any more greens. I'd had enough. And this is what's left over, the bulbs in here. Yep, these are three-month-old bulbs, and you can just imagine how pithy they are. But you know what? I'm going to try chopping these up and simmering them down with water for maybe a couple hours and see if they can soften up. You know, I don't want to waste anything. Radishes, what I've learned from radishes is, yes, you can grow them indoors. You need bright light. And if you grow them for the leaves, which are delicious, you get so much more than you normally would with just the bulbs. So you can make a choice. Grow them for the bulbs, which they will form, or grow them for the leaves. This information will help you indoors or outdoors for gardening. And so I never thought I could grow radishes indoors. I learned something. Now one of the last lessons I learned was, if you're going to grow a pumpkin indoors, you best have some room. I grew a sugar pumpkin, and it started over here in the corner, and it grew over past the agave, and that's when I tied it to the trellis over here, the trellis that's mounted on the wall, because I wanted to help it grow along the lights that are up here so that it would have brighter light, because if it was trailing on the floor, it wouldn't get as much light, and they do need a lot of light. You got to grow them in full sun, so I was kind of skeptical about how well it would do here. In the voodoo garden, even though it has lights, it's nowhere near full sun. But look at this. I'm just slowly panning around. Look at all the flowers. Yes, dozens and dozens of flowers. Now, right about here in that corner is where I last hooked it up. And then from there on, it used tendrils to drag itself along this light. See, I didn't do any of this. This plant naturally knew where the light was. And it hooked its tendrils in there, and it's just going and going. Every single morning, there's new flowers in here. And one of the things that I learned about this is, it's very difficult, if not impossible, for me to get these to produce pumpkins, even though there were male flowers, female flowers, all over the place, and I pollinated them, the bulbs, the pumpkins did not take the pollen. They would just, the flower would die off, and then the bulb, the pumpkin, would slowly fade away. So the pollination didn't take. And the flowers, though, are delicious. I've been eating flowers and letting flowers go. I want to kind of a little of both. I want to see the flowers, smell the flowers, but I want to eat them too. So I've been letting a lot of them just fade away. And those, nothing goes to waste. This whole plant will be taken out and fed to the chickens and goat. Yep, nothing here goes to waste, not at all. And a couple of these plants, the tropical plants, like the agave here, this one I'm going to give to somebody in Atlantic. There's somebody that Mike knows that wants to grow this. Why? I don't ask questions about why they want to grow it, but I'm just going to give them to him, and he's going to enjoy this. This one, the Prince of Orange, this is a philodendron that I grew. It's got babies. Yep, I'm going to take the babies, and I'm giving this plant away as well. See, I've been taking my time and finding homes for these. I don't ship them, I don't mail them, but locally, I try and source out people who might want to enjoy this. And this one, when I took a picture and I sent it with Mike, yep, one of the girls at Walmart is definitely going to be loving this plant. So it's going to have a good home. There was one last plant that this one I'm keeping. This was that orange, the citrus type plant. Yep, it's flowering and the smell is just heavenly. I love citrus blossoms. So this one's going upstairs. It's going in a southern facing window and it's going to be growing here in the house for as long as it wants to. It's been a heck of a journey, hasn't it? Yep, I already said my goodbyes on the Voodoo Garden channel and told folks that I was done filming on that channel for the programs. I am leaving all of those programs up on the Voodoo Garden channel, so if you ever want to find out anything about indoor gardening, the fun that we've been through all of these years, all of those programs are going to stay up, and you can watch them, you can comment on them, and I will always be here to answer your questions. So if you post any comments on any one of my programs on whichever channel it is, I will see it, I will answer it. No problem there. So it's not like the channel is done. It's just that I'm done filming for that, but the programs will still be there for you. The Voodoo Garden, as I mentioned before, is going to be turned into shelving and storage for a little shop of seeds because it's grown to where I can't maintain it in the little tiny space in my basement. It needs more room. And I thought, well, what a better, a good finish for the Voodoo Garden is to be the area where I have all of those seeds, which I call little tiny bits of potential. Every seed is potential. So all of that potential all stocked up here in the Voodoo Garden. And that goes with what I used to say in the Voodoo Garden, that all things are possible. All you need is a seed, an idea, and the will to just try. And I believe that you can do so many more things than you think that you can. And with that, I am going to start chopping up and eating. I feel like such a villain. But yes, I'm going to start getting things taken care of here in the Voodoo Garden. Oh, don't forget. Keep joining me here next week. I think it's next week. Next week or the week after. I don't know. Maybe next week. We'll be outside. Yes, we will. We still have weekend edition. Don't worry about that. I still have another one to film. And we also have some stuff going on outside. So make sure that you tune in every now and then if you want to check up and see how I'm doing. Until then, everybody, have a great day.